building your team is an exciting phase of your entrepreneurial career. You basically move from job seeker to job giver. So when you start a company, you know, initially you will be all alone. Sooner or later, you will find that you need people to support your your activities, and then slowly you grow your team. Team formation is a very, very crucial thing in a business venture, especially in the very starting time, because if you don't assemble your team properly, most likely that you will encounter huge problems in the initial stages. Because in the initial stages of building a venture, your resources and manpower are very limited, and you will carry out your entire operation with a limited set of individuals, with typically 2 to 3 individuals at the initial period. And these individuals, you know, they have complete access to all your vital information of your company, which involves all the technical details and the other operational aspects of your company. So you need to retain these guys by motivating them, by providing certain perks which is beyond their salaries, and you have to show them that they are going to have a great future by sticking on to your company. Otherwise, it is very difficult to retain them, and if you are not able to retain those guys in the very early stage, you will really face a tough time. So I have seen a lot of startups who struggled to retain people. And not only they lost the manpower, they also lost their credible information pertaining to your company, which was a very serious which has landed them into a very serious problem later on. So this is something that you have to be very cautious and carefully dealt with. So let us start with building your team. So let us start our discussion with what a leadership is. Sooner or later, when you start a company, you need to wear the hat of a leader, irrespective of whether you personally like it or not. Probably you may be a person who doesn't like leadership, or you are not very fancied person for leadership. But irrespective of your nature or your personal willingness, by virtue of starting a company, by virtue of starting a startup, you automatically become a leader. Your nature of leadership and the nature of your leadership qualities possessed by you has a great impact on your team. So let us see what are the important leadership qualities of a leader, of a leader, and then we'll proceed further. So what is leadership? Leadership is an act of motivating a group of individuals to act towards a common goal. Okay, so all the individuals should be motivated, and all of them should be directed to achieve a common goal of your organization. You as a leader should motivate a group of individuals and show them the path in order to achieve a common goal of an organization. The most predominant goal of an organization is to expand their revenue and to create values to their customers in the most ethical way possible. So that is the goal of any organization. So that is how leadership has to be driving the team. These are the three important leadership styles that are present in any organization. The important leadership styles: first one is autocratic leadership, number one. Number two, it is shared leadership. This is also called as democratic leadership. Democratic or shared leadership. The third type of leadership is laissez-faire leadership, number three. These are the three types of leaderships. Styles which are present in entrepreneurship. We will see them one by one. First one is autocratic leadership. In autocratic leadership, the leader dictates terms to their employees. the leader dictate terms, he is authoritative in nature, he drives the team by commanding them, he instructs them what has to be done, he is a kind of a leader who tells the employee, you do it my way or highway kind of a leader. So a leader who is authoritative, who instructs or commands the team members is an autocratic leader. Such a leadership is called autocratic leadership. In autocratic leadership, communication is normally one-directional, which means the leader normally tells the team members to do what he wants to do. He never accepts any ideas or suggestions or thoughts by the team members. It is more likely a one-directional flow of commands. You simply do what I say kind of a leadership. This kind of autocratic leadership create negative emotions, and the team members are most likely that they get dissatisfied with this kind of leadership. If you take a survey on what is the major reason behind people switching over from one company to other, the most predominantly answered one is the financial component. The other one is the bad behavior of the boss. So if you don't show good attitude and good kind of leadership, it is very difficult to retain people. And for a company with thousands of employees, it doesn't matter. If one or two employees move out of the company, they can always replace that systematically. But for a small organization, for a startup, which is revolving around a few individuals, losing those individuals at the very early stage because of lack of leadership is a pretty bad thing to do. So autocratic leadership creates lack of ownership. There is no sense of belonging. Like the employees, they don't feel like this company is my company, I have to work for it. That sense of belonging has to be there. You can basically determine the basic intention of an employee by the very language he speaks to somebody else in your absence. If he uses words like my boss company, this company, that company, that doesn't show any attachment that particular individual has over the organization. A person who is deeply attached, who has a lot of love for the organization, always use words like my company, our company, so on and so forth. So this is how bosses understand what is the level of commitment and love that particular individual has for a specific company. And in autocratic kind of leadership, most likely the employees will miss the target. And the productivity of the entire system goes down. Okay. So this is not an ideal kind of leadership that you should possess as a leader of your startup. So this is something that you should avoid. Here comes the most preferred or highly encouraged kind of leadership, namely democratic or shared leadership. In democratic or shared leadership, the leader joins with the team. Okay, so he becomes part of the team. Leader becomes part of the team. Many leaders in the organization exhibit this kind of leadership quality. They simply merge with the team as if they are a common man. And if you see seasoned entrepreneurs, they don't wear any big fancy dress when they move out with their employees. They wear a simple t-shirt Have you seen the Facebook CEO or a Google CEO wearing costly costumes or attire when they merge with their employees? No, they simply wear a round neck t-shirt or a normal t-shirt and they simply move around. So they don't show as if they are the boss of the organization. They act as if they are one of the employees of the organization and they simply casually move around. And that is how it has to be. So the leaders merge with the team and they become part of the team. And in shared leadership, the leader offers freedom and opportunity to contribute. Each individual brings something to the table, like they provide their idea. This gives them a sense of ownership. This gives them that kind of confidence and that kind of trust and that kind of, a sense of ownership, which makes them to stick with the company for a long time. So in shared leadership, the leader offers freedom and opportunity to contribute for the system. And eventually, the leader leads the way, and each individual fulfills their responsibility. There is a sense of ownership. There is a sense of trust among the team. And this kind of a leadership provides great amount of productivity for a startup. And this shared leadership is something which creates trust and sense of ownership among the team. So which is the most preferred kind of leadership quality? Okay, so this is something. This can only be motivated by your personal attachment. It has to be all personal at the very early stage, nothing professional. You cannot frame rules. You cannot dictate terms with your employees, at least at the early stage. You can do that once you grow big, but in the very early stage, it's all personal. You have to deal with them in a very personalized way. You have to address their concerns. You have to talk to them frequently. You have to feel that if you feel that they are unhappy, go and address them quickly. So it has to be that way, dealt that way. Third thing comes the laissez-faire kind of a leadership. Laissez-faire kind of a leadership is an exact opposite of autocratic leadership, where you give too much of a freedom for your team members. Like you don't offer any guidelines. You offer don't set any desired path of how the employees should walk through. You simply let them off and don't guide them properly, and then simply completely allow them to do things on their own. This is called laissez-faire. Laissez-faire kind of is a leadership where the boss or the leader completely gives the entire freedom to the employees and ask them to do it on their own way. This is also a completely misleading or a dangerous kind of a situation, because in such a situation, too much of a freedom will confuse the employee. He doesn't know, he becomes totally aimless. And especially if you are a employee who is taking the job for the very first time, who doesn't have prior experience, if you doesn't have any kind of a guidance from the management team, it will be a totally aimless kind of a thing. And this is again another reason why employees leave an organization. Many of them say that they don't get proper guidance from their core team. Okay, so they are totally in the blind and they don't have any information whatsoever with regard to what is their role in the organization. The very first thing that you as an entrepreneur should do is to define the roles of an employee the day one he joins your organization. Tell them what is expected out of him, what are their responsibilities that he has to fulfill, and this is what is the expected target on month-on-month basis. This is something that you have to share to the employee on day one. Don't, if you think that probably it is not the right time to share with them, probably you can share with them after 6 months of time after their training period is over. By the time you take a decision, it will be too late, I am telling you. So laissez-faire leadership is one where you don't have any structure of how to execute a task. each one is doing in their own direction, and it will be a total chaos and confusion in the company. So this is something which is highly dangerous, and at the end of the day, no one can be held accountable for the failure. No one takes the responsibility for the failure, because there is no clear directions of how they have to act upon a specific task. So this is something which is equally dangerous as autocratic. In autocratic leadership, you don't give any freedom at all. In laissez-faire, it is exactly opposite to that. You completely give the complete ownership. That is also equally dangerous. So which one is best suited? Autocratic leadership is obviously going to create negative emotions, and it is going to depress your employees. Laissez-faire, on the other hand, you are giving too much of a freedom where they totally go aimless, and there is a total confusion and chaos in the system, and nobody is held accountable for the failure. And it is this kind of leadership, the democratic or a shared kind of leadership, which is highly preferred in a startup. You be the captain of the ship, and you drive the team, and you motivate them, and you bring success to your company. So that is how leadership has to be. The second part of our discussion today is team formation. In the team formation, first one comes onboarding a co-founder. Who is a co-founder? By virtue of starting a company, you are the founder of a company. Founder or founding person or the chairman of the company. Who is a co-founder? A co-founder is an individual who complement your skills, who support your entrepreneurship journey in all possible ways, who has mutual respect and trust for you, who is equally passionate and dream about your company, whom you can trust and live for a longer time. It is something similar to your marriage kind of a thing. Selecting a co-founder has to be done in an extremely cautious manner. First of all, you have to decide whether you need one or not. Most likely, it is better that you have a co-founder for a variety of reasons. Probably you may want to have a co-founder for sharing your burden, share your work burden, or share your risk involved in the business, financial risk, you want to mitigate it, or you wanted to have an individual for complementing your skill. You are a hardware designer. You want an individual with software skills to mutually complement your business. There can be n number of reasons why you wanted to have a co-founder. And then at the end of the day, when you are growing big, when your company grows to a bigger company, you may have to pitch for funding in front of an investor. And when you are pitching your company for investment, the investors see this particular criteria as one of the very important criteria, that if a company is a sole proprietorship company or which is having a single founder, most likely that they don't encourage funding such companies. They normally wanted to have at least 2 to 3 co-founders or in the form of a team. Fund a particular company. So having a co-founder is not a bad thing at all, provided you have the right reasons for that. So who is a co-founder? Someone who can share your vision and responsibility of a startup. Someone who is equally passionate as you are. Okay, so onboarding a co-founder is a very carefully has to be done in a very extremely careful manner, because having a bad co-founder can kill your business in no time. That is something that I am telling in the very first line. Be clear on why you need a co-founder. Why should I have a co-founder? Whether I should have a person who is sharing my burden, whether I wanted to mitigate my risk, whether should I have a person who can share my risk, or whether I need a person who can complement my skills. Just I told you that I am a hardware guy. I am looking for someone who is extremely good in software, or a person who has a similar vision who can travel with me for a longer run. What are the criteria that a co-founder is going to have? What are the justifications that you should have in a co-founder to onboard him in your organization? You have to be extremely clear in the very first stage. Second one, you create a profile for your co-founder. What are the expected qualities that you expect from a co-founder? List them in the form of a profile, and then search for appropriate profile in your nearby network, through social media, and through lot of channels available. And then last but not the least, fourth item, before you onboard him, do the necessary paperwork. Paperwork means all the necessary contracts, legal papers, defining what is the roles and responsibilities of your co-founder, what is the role that he has in your organization. What are the important things that you need to note, before onboarding a person as a co-founder in your organization? Number one, whether that particular individual is equally passionate about your company's vision and ideology, or whether he is approaching your company just for making money, whether he is using your startup just as a money-making machine, or he's, say, for example, you might be having a vision that I don't do any unethical things. Of course, profit matters, but I don't involve in any unethical ways to bring in profit for my organization. That is a policy that I have for my organization. That probably that is your vision. Suppose if you are bringing in a partner who is willing to do anything for profit, like he is but not bothered about ethical or unethical ways, he is justly is a kind of a person who is focused only on bringing in money, irrespective of the type of method that is following. This kind of an engagement is not going to work out for a longer period. So you have to understand whether your vision and his vision is matching, and your ideology and the individual's ideology is matching, so that you can travel together for a long time. Number two, whether you are going to have the trust and confidence amongst each other, whether you understand each other's thought process clearly, and whether you motivate each other to succeed, and whether you clearly divide the roles and responsibilities for your organization. For example, you take any big company, take Google, one fellow does the finance part, the other fellow takes care of the business part, the other fellow takes care of the technology part. So you have to have a very clear division of roles and responsibilities, and also take decision on who will take the lead role and who will take the supportive role. So these kind of things, you have to be extremely transparent at the very early stage, openly discuss with your co-founder, and put them in black and white. Never assume things. Don't give any gray area, or don't assume things. Let all be in black and white stage. Okay. So once your founder is done, next one comes hiring a team. Hiring a team is a very exciting stage of your business. Probably you must be, before coming to your hiring a team, probably you must be tired of sending resume to company after company before you start your startup. When you become a owner and when you see that there are a lot of resumes coming for a job, you feel really excited, and you feel that there is a sense of pride coming to you. It is really an exciting phase of your entrepreneurship journey. But then hiring a team has to be dealt in a very careful manner, as I told you at the beginning of the stage. Hiring a wrong individual to your team can be a very costly mistake. So what are the hiring strategies that I should adopt for hiring a team? for my organization. So that is the topic of next discussion. The very first strategy that I would tell you is delay the hiring as long as you can. Don't hire somebody. Hiring is always going to cost your company. I have to pay money. It is going to be month on month fixed expense for me. It is going to drain my financial assets. So delay my hiring as long as you can. Don't hire them at a very early stage just because you want somebody. Don't take pride in telling that my company has 10 employees. One person, before the COVID period, he just visited my our incubation center, and he was explaining something about the product and other stuff, and he was getting some ideas so as to increase the sales and so on and so forth. And I was curious to ask what was his team size, and he told me that his team size was 20 odd people, and I was astonished to see that, and I haven't openly discouraged him, but then having such a team, large team size at the very early stage when you are getting a small peanut profit is not an advisable thing to have. The small meager amount of profit that you earn will be drained very easily in terms of providing salary to such a large team. So there is no point in recruiting a large team and keep them idle when you are not sure of whether they really need such a big team or not. So delay hiring as long as you can. Go for recruiting somebody if and only if it is really mandatory to do that. Otherwise, don't do it. Why? Because hiring a resource will always going to cost your company. It is going to drain your financial resources. Don't do that unless otherwise it is absolutely necessary. And third one, last but not the least, hiring a wrong person seriously hurts your startup. I have seen many startups where an individual with wrong intentions, an individual who joined an organization just for the sake of money. Money is the only criteria for that particular individual. And a few of the startups have not screened that particular individual properly, and they just like that recruited them in a hurry. And one fine day, he just took all the credential information of that particular company, including the technical part of it. So that is the end of the story for that startup. So that should not happen for you. Okay. So even this you can manage. Okay. If there is some shortage of funds, you can do. But if you don't recruit a credible person to an organization, that will be a very serious mistake for a startup. So that you keep in mind. So how would I start recruiting my particular team? What is my hiring mode? So at the initial stages, I start with interns. Why interns? Interns are available at very, very, very cheap cost. Probably I can offer some minimal amount of stipend for them at the early stage. Many of the interns are final year graduates. Many of them have not completed their graduation. Probably they need some industrial exposure. They are desperately looking for some kind of an industrial interaction. They are the first team of people whom I would make use of for my organization. Because two things, because they are extremely fresh in terms of if you throw some problem to them, they come out with out of the box thinking, and then they will give you solutions for any kind of problems that you have. Whereas if you throw the same thing, if you go for brainstorming with old individuals, probably they may be having a lot of experience, but they don't have that kind of a out of the box thinking. They traditionally give solutions only with their known things and their with something they are accustomed to. They don't come up with fresh ideas. So that is something that you can avail from interns. Second one, you can avail them with cheaper cost. Your cost to the company is extremely small. You can offer them a small stipend. They will happily come and work for you. So that is the first group of individuals whom you should target for your organization. Second one, you should go for freelancers. There are a lot of outstanding freelancers out there. if you do some small amount of search, you can go for credible amount of freelancers. The one bad thing about freelancers is that you are sharing a lot of detailed technical level information of your company with that particular individual. So when you are interacting with your freelancers, make sure that you are always signing a non-disclosure agreement. NDA stands for non-disclosure agreement. Non-disclosure agreement means that particular individual whom you are engaging with will not share your secret information to somebody. If he does, he is legally liable and you can sue him in the court of law. So that is what it is. It is an agreement. So that agreement has to be signed between the company and the freelancer before you start engaging with that particular freelancer. Engaging with freelancer also is a best choice, because he is going, why to engage with freelancer? Freelancer is obviously going to charge you for the work that he is going to do. He is not going to charge you for month on month salary. For whatever the work he is going to do, he is going to charge. Otherwise, you are not going to offer any fixed payment for it. So that is the best option. Third one, go for contractual employees, like project-based employees. I engage a group of individuals for fulfilling only for a fixed duration of time for a specific project. And later on, if I don't require them, I can let them go. So that is one kind of a methodology where you don't engage in full-time employment. The last full-time employees has to be used if it is really necessary. So you go for this kind of employment if it is really needed. So I don't recommend you to go for full-time employment if it doesn't have any valid reason. Okay. So of course you should have some full-time employees, few of them, but not your entire strength. So it has to be a heterogeneous mixture of all these four buckets that you make sure. Next one, who to hire? Who are the individuals whom I am going to hire for my team? What are the profiles of the people that I am looking for? Whether I am looking for a technically competent individual for my technology part, whether I need individuals for managing my business part, whether I need individuals for taking care of skilled and semi-skilled part of my business, for if I'm running a manufacturing company, for manufacturing certain things, and probably I may require certain skilled and semi-skilled thing. Say for example, in our incubation center, we designed a small product day before yesterday. Dispensing unit. A touch-free dispensing unit, which would deploy your sanitizer in a touch-free mode. Many of these guys are pressing the some pedals or pressing something. So it's a touch-free hands sanitizer. So you can just show your hand; the sensor would automatically sense and then it will deploy it. Now, for such a sanitizer, if I'm going to, the government of Puducherry asked a few numbers for this. Now, if you are going to deploy this particular unit, you don't need actually, a high-end labor for this. ITI pass or a ITI or a diploma level candidate is good enough for assembling this. So, what I'm trying to tell you is, suppose if I'm going to, mass manufacture that particular machine, I don't require basically, graduate engineers or MBA for doing that. So I require only skilled or semi-skilled workers whom I can fabricate and give the enclosures, the electronics, there is a printed circuit board inside which takes care of the electronics. Once I do everything, it is a matter of assembling and testing that. So it requires a small skilled and semi-skilled team for that. So whether you need such individuals for your company, or doing unskilled jobs like doing some kind of an office work, or going here and there for doing postal work, or for going to banks for some kind of an office work, or for transportation, or taking this and depositing here, some kind of a refuse, whether you need unskilled labor. So all these things, you have to create a profile. So what kind of profile I need, whether I need a technical individual for leading my team, whether I need a management person for leading my business, whether I need skilled or semi-skilled workers for assembling products in my company, whether I need an unskilled labor for doing a general purpose task. So you need to create a profile first. And then where to look for the team members. The most easiest way to do is to post your advertisement in the company website. You just simply post your job openings in your company website. Serious individuals frequently scan your company, and then they come across if there is an opening, and then they will start applying for it. You can, if you are a startup which is residing inside the institute, the best way is to post your recruitment notification in the college notice board, where it can attract the eyes of a lot of potential candidates. You can also take the help of job sites like Naukri, Monster, and so on and so forth. They can do that service on paid basis. You can also take the help of social media. This is the most powerful way of doing that today, especially in using LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a very powerful place where you can attract a lot of talents and you can assemble your team. So these are all the places where you would look for. And a word of caution, two things that you have to justify yourself before you start recruiting a team. Whether your startup can really afford to hire. Whether really afford to hire means whether you have the financial resources to hire your team. Whether it is necessary to hire your team. As far as possible, you do things on your own at the very early stage. Don't go for expanding a team. I told you an example where an individual is not sure of what to sell, where to sell, but he's already having a team of 20 individuals. I don't know whether he's running any comedy show or not. Having such a large group of individuals in a team where a particular individual is not sure of what to do is a very bad strategy. So these are the two things that you really keep in mind. So this is something we call it as a hiring template. Hiring template is a template that you as a owner of your organization should prepare. So let us say I am hiring a resource for digital marketing. I need an individual who can expose my company in the digital world and he can create leads. So I need an individual for digital marketing expert. So this is the post that I am looking for. That is the role that I am looking for. So name of the role that you are looking for hiring. That is the number one. Second one, what are the key responsibilities of this particular role? What are the key responsibilities means what this particular individual needed to fulfill in terms of job responsibilities? What are his expectations? This you will give it to that individual on day one. Don't delay too long. The day he joins, you hand out the responsibility sheet to him and tell him, welcome aboard, gentlemen. This is all the responsibilities that you need to fulfill. And these are all the expectations from us. This is your monthly target. And this is where you have to report to all this complete information you have to share. Before that, you have to have a clear, detailed outlay of what are the responsibilities of that particular individual. So since this is being a digital marketing expert, you should have a complete understanding of how digital marketing works, how to do lead creation, how to do customer funneling, and how to contact customers and how to acquire them, and how to post, where to post, what is the amount that he has to incur for doing the marketing efforts, what is the return for the investment. There is something called ROI. ROI means what is the return on the investment that you make on the marketing efforts. So all these key parameters that that particular individual should be absolutely aware of. So these are all the key responsibilities, and then the key skills that that particular individual should prefer, individual should prefer. So what are the key skills? Skills means what is this proficiency, technical proficiency that you are looking for. He should be more likely that he should have a degree in pertaining to digital marketing, or he should have computer literacy. He should have a well professional in dealing with social media websites. Having a knowledge in website design and writing blogs and posts is an added advantage. And if he's able to do a lot of creative designs and a lot of interesting designs in graphics and multimedia, it will be an added plus. So what are all the skill sets that you expect from that particular individual? You list out. And then where to look for such candidates. Just now I listed out a lot of places where to look for, whether you are going to look for in LinkedIn or whether you are going for posting an advertisement in newspaper. So those kind of things that you have to identify. And then finally, the hiring mode. Hiring mode means whether you are going to recruit him as a freelancer, whether you are going to recruit him as a full-time employee, or whether you are going to recruit him on part-time basis. All those things have to be decided based on your financial budget available with you. This is called a hiring template. This hiring template has to be created by the individual who is owning the company, which is you, at the very early stage before you recruit somebody. At the very early stage, when you are going for recruiting a team, these are the important roles that you should look for. One lead role, that is yourself. As the CEO, you are going to drive the ship at the very early stage. Once your company grows extremely big with thousands of employees, probably you can look for employing a CEO. But then till then, it is your role. Lead role has to be taken care of by you. And you should have a very good, extremely talented technical individual. The technical manager. This fellow should transform customer ideas or customer specifications into a commercial grade product immediately. He should be extremely talented technical wise. He should get the specifications from the customer and he should do engineering analysis, and he has to come out with an interesting product in no time. The next one is the financial person. The financial person is the one who do all the budgeting for their company. He is the one who is going to manage the sales, the revenue part, and the complete financial part. It is always better to have one. And last but not the least, he is also going to take care of the compliance part. Compliance means the taxation part. Okay, so once you start a company and the money starts to come in, till then nobody will be bothered about you. The moment your company's current account starts having money flow, lot of departments will come and ask questions, especially the IT department. So till then nobody is bothered. So for taking care of all those compliance requirements, it is always better you have a financial guy. Last but not the least, the core, hardcore marketing and sales individuals. They are the ones who do all the, who bring all the money for the organization. They are the frontline players. They take your product to the market and they sell it and bring revenue to the organizations. They are the, gods for our organization. They are the ones who really bring in revenue and funding for the organization. So they have, you need to recruit a highly dynamic marketing and sales individuals. These are the key roles that you should identify at the very early stage. Of course, the lead role can be yours. Rest of the three roles, you have to identify a suitable individual at the very early stage. Some of the hiring tips. The very first hiring tip is always hire an individual who is equally passionate about your vision and he doesn't come for monetary benefits. If you are recruiting a money-minded individual, the problem of that is, suppose if he is getting an opportunity of another company who is ready to pay 1,000 rupees extra for what he is getting currently now, then that particular individual will dump your company and move out. So the very first thing that you are going to ensure before you hire an individual is whether that particular individual is really passionate about what your vision is, whether he is really passionate about what you are doing, and whether he is desperate to be part of your team just because his line of interest is in line with what you are doing, or he is simply acting just to join your company for the sake of money. So you have to be extremely cautious in identifying that motto on the very first stage. Number one, at the very early stage, I always recommend you to do a multi-faced personality. Multi-faced personality means an individual who can fit in multiple roles. Like for some period, he has to be a designer. For some period, he has to do the marketing role. For some period, he has to do, you know, some kind of a sales role. Some period of time, he has to do some kind of totally irrelevant activity for which he is hired for. So these are some of the key components that you should look for, because there are times where in a startup, you don't have a huge manpower. A single particular individual may have to fit in a lot of roles. So if you recruit an individual who is a very strict headmaster kind of an individual who will say, oh, I have been recruited as a design engineer, so I will work only in R&D department. If you ask me to go to, you know, sales, if you ask me to take a sales call, that is not my job. If you are going to recruit that kind of an individual, it is really not going to work for you. So you really focus on individuals who are extremely dynamic and who is willing to take multiple job roles without any hesitation or murmur at the very early stage. This is something that you should take care of. The most important thing is you verify the credibility of that individual before you take him on board. Okay, it is always better you take somebody whom you know the credibility track of the individual on the longer run. Assembling a team is a very costly affair at the very early stage. Don't simply just like that allow somebody to gain access to confidential resources at the very early stage. If you don't have any other choice, you have completely run out of manpower that you have to rely on external sources, then do some kind of background checking always. There are professional agencies who do that, but still I would recommend you to do that background checking at personal level. Interact with a lot of colleagues of that particular individual, call that individual's old companies where he has already worked with. So those kind of background verification you do before you offer him a offer letter. So that is something that is very important, because if you recruit a wrong individual, it will doom your company. The fourth recruitment tip that I would give you is always recruit in pairs. Suppose if you need a single resource, I would recommend you to go for recruiting two such resources. The reason being, if the out of the two, if one individual is extremely talented and is delivering all the goods that you needed, the other individual most likely he may resign and go because he will never cope up in such an environment. The second thing, if both the individuals are mutually complementing each other and if they are equally delivering the goods, then it will be a big asset for your organization. Either ways, it will work out. But identifying a single individual and identifying a single member for your group is slightly risky. this is some kind of a thing that I would tell you at the for the recruitment part. So this is something that I wanted to share you today. And hiring a team, as I told you, is a pretty exciting stage of your organization. That is where you know, that sense of ownership, that sense of being a team leader, that sense of, you know, giving salary to somebody always, you know, motivates you. That is fine. But don't get carried away too much and then, you know, you put yourself into trouble. These are all certain things that you have to take care of at the very early stage.